Well, thanks very much for the opportunity to present to you guys here today. And as was mentioned, I direct an office at McGill, which is, of course, one of Canada's top universities, and I'm a professor. So I want to start out with a professorial story. And there was one day a prof who walked out in front of a large class and wanted to make a point. And he picked up a bottle with a wriggling live worm in it and poured in a little bit of alcohol and the worm died. Picked up another bottle with a live worm in it, poured in a little bit of chocolate syrup and the worm died. And repeated this with yet a third bottle. And this time he poured in a little bit of chocolate liqueur and tobacco juice and the worm died. And then he looked out at the audience and he asked the students, "What do you make of that?" And one inventive little kid in the back said, "Sir, sir, I know. If you drink, smoke, and eat chocolate, you don't have to worry about worms." Well, what's the point here? The point is that he made the right observation, but he came to the wrong conclusion. And science is all about making observations and coming to conclusions. My area is chemistry. And when I was told to come and speak to you guys here, I really wasn't told what to say. I knew that this was something about design. So what do I do in terms of design? I design presentations, lectures of all kinds, TV shows, radio shows, to try to demystify science, to make sure that people think about science in the right way. And let me tell you, that is a challenging type of design. Because what we are trying to do is to guide people to go down the right path. Life is all about making decisions about which path to take. And very often, let me tell you, it is a chemical decision. You wake up in the morning, you decide what kind of coffee to drink, regular or decaf. If decaf, how decaf? The Swiss water process or the dry cleaning process? What are you going to have for lunch? Is it going to be pizza or smoked meat or what is it going to be? What are you going to have for supper? What are you going to cook it in? Is it going to be copper or stainless steel or aluminum? People are concerned about these things because they've heard of the connection between aluminum and Alzheimer's disease, for example. Well, I've been cooking in aluminum all my life, and I don't remember any problems. So we try to guide people on how to make scientific decisions. But it's a challenge, because you bring up the word chemistry, and it scares people. They think of chemists as being sort of evil creatures just bent on putting some new cancer-causing additive to our food supply. They look at it as the work of the devil. Well, not to me. To me, chemistry is basically magical. And believe it or not, I got started in this whole business through a mix of chemistry and magic. How did that happen? Well, it was a long time ago when I was back in elementary school and I was invited to a birthday party. That was a couple years ago. And there was an entertainer who was a magician. He wasn't very good. He was a teenager. Most of the tricks he did were eminently forgettable. But there was one that turned out to be memorable. Let me show you. He told us that he had the ability to make ropes defy gravity. Well, I didn't know what on earth he was talking about. But then he took a flexible rope and he reached into his pocket to get what he said was a magic chemical, which he sprinkled on the rope. And believe it or not, that rope defied gravity. I didn't know what on earth was going on here, how he did this, but I knew that if I tried to do that, that's what would happen. I can only do that to ropes, actually. I didn't know how he did it, but I knew that it wasn't with any magic chemical. Where did those words come from? Why not abracadabra or hocus pocus? Why magic chemical? So I went into the school library, I took a book on magic, took out a book on chemistry, and I have followed both of those. And you might think that that's a very bizarre juxtaposition, but it actually isn't. Because chemistry is magical until you understand how it works. And my emphasis is to try to demystify it. Because chemistry is everywhere. It's the thread that ties all of the other sciences together, literally and figuratively. It is the fabric of our life, because if you understand what molecules can and cannot do, you understand how things work, you understand how to make dyes, you understand what compact discs are made of and how they function, you understand cleaning agents, you understand the medications that we take and the food that we eat, because all of that is just one big collage of chemicals. many, many, many chemicals. Believe it or not, the most recent listing in Chemical Abstract, which is a compendium of known chemicals, is 60 million. Now, the vast majority of those, over 99%, are naturally occurring. But those are not the ones that people are interested in or focus on. They worry about the synthetic chemicals because they perceive that somehow those are more dangerous, those are more toxic. So we live in a world of chemicals, and we, in fact, are nothing more than a large bag of chemicals. And we put chemicals into our body. The coffee that you had this morning, believe it or not, its aroma is composed of about 1,000 compounds. And most of these are known. They have been identified. We know their molecular structure. We then put this into our body, which is a large bag of chemicals. And I know that people are perturbed to hear that because they think that chemicals are substances that should be in the laboratory. No. Everything in the world, of course, is made up of chemicals. Unfortunately, my profession, I know that when we bring up that word, people get scared. But chemicals are not to be feared, neither are they to be worshipped. They are to be understood. But in the world out there, so often, when you mention chemical, it becomes synonymous with toxin. People get worried. They want a chemical-free existence. This is one of the banes of my life whenever I see this expression. When you're buying something that's chemical-free, you're not getting a good deal. Let me tell you why. If it's advertised as chemical-free, there really is nothing in it. Now, even that jar isn't actually chemical-free because it's full of air. And air, obviously, is a mixture of many chemicals. So you're not getting a good deal. But nevertheless, people want to bring up their kids in a chemical-free fashion. And believe it or not, they want them to play with chemistry sets that require no chemicals. You can imagine how to a chemist, this is like putting a knife and twisting it. To want to sell chemistry sets with no chemicals. A 4% solution of acetic acid is looked upon as some kind of toxic substance. But if you call it vinegar, it becomes an organic, natural cleaning agent. People are horrified if they're told that they're going to be eating beta-fructofuranosyl alpha-D-glucopyranoside. They get all scared about that. But the only thing that I've told you is that you're going to be eating some sugar. That's the chemical name for sugar. And obviously, because we live in a world of over 60 million chemicals, we have to have unique names. So it has to be systematic, and often, of course, that becomes pretty complex. But this idea that if you can't pronounce it, you shouldn't be eating it, has become pervasive, thanks to this lady who labels herself the food babe. She has no scientific education whatsoever, but she's all over the web giving advice about chemicals. This was one of her famous ones. You wouldn't eat a yoga mat, would you? And she attacked Subway with this, suggesting that they were putting the same chemical into their food that is used in yoga mats. Well, in a sense they were. There's a small amount of a chemical called azo dicarbonamide that is added to the bread in order to make it rise. It's totally inconsequential. And it's also added to yoga mats for the same reason. You want foam, so you want bubbles in it. But the image that she created was that chemists are dosing the Subway rolls with gallons of this substance and, of course, trying to kill off the population. The fact is that if you have a chemical that you use in one context, it doesn't mean you can't use it safely somewhere else. After all, we use water to wash our garage floors. It doesn't mean that we can't drink it. But this is the myth that this lady propagates. And it actually gets worse than that. She asks the question, do you eat beaver butt? Well, where does this come from? It turns out that beavers actually have a gland near their rear end that produces a vast array of chemicals. Not surprising. Animals, of course, are composed of chemicals. She suggests that if you're eating ice cream, you're eating beaver butt or beaver butt extract. Why? Well, it turns out that when you actually do extract these glands, you get a mixture of compounds. These have a scent. They're actually used in perfumery. The mixture is called castoreum. You may have heard of that. It's used in the most expensive perfumes. It also turns out that some of these have a vanilla-like flavor. She read that somewhere and assumed that this is where the vanilla in the ice cream could come from. which of course is not the case at all. This would not be economical to extract this compound from beavers and put it into ice cream. We can make vanillin very easily. Of course, you can extract it from the vanilla bean, but you can also do it in the laboratory. You can take chemicals from pulp and paper waste and convert them into vanillin. And of course, the final product is exactly the same as what you would extract from the vanilla bean. But this really scared people. And this lady has millions of followers on her website and on Facebook. She makes people paranoid about what they are eating. But this idea of eating beaver butt is just silly. But even if it were true, so what? We eat beef butt. We call it steak, right? I mean, we do eat animals. So this is the kind of nonsense I like to get rid of because it just scares people out there unnecessarily. So that's what my office is dedicated to at McGill. We try to unravel the mysteries of life. I mean, we focus on what chemistry can do. Chemistry is in the limelight because everything that happens in our life is basically built off chemicals, or the reactions involve chemicals, and we need to understand this. In order to make fertilizer, we need to understand chemistry. In order to make the drugs that we use, we need to understand chemistry. In order to understand disease processes, how the body uses chemicals to repair DNA, for example. Well, that's worked out by chemists. And you may know that yesterday, the Nobel Prize in Chemistry was awarded to three researchers exactly for that kind of chemical work, for finding out how the body repairs its DNA. The plastics in our life make our life easier. Everything that you see in that picture in that airplane is made of plastic. It's light. Without this, we wouldn't be flying around like we do. Plastics, of course, have a downside as well, because we need to emphasize recycling. These things can stay around forever. But that's not the fault of the plastic. That plastic bag that ends up in the mouth of some fish or turtle in the ocean didn't jump there by itself. It's people's behavior that's the problem. There are skeletons in our closet. And there's no question about that. I'm the first one to admit that sometimes in our history, we haven't disposed of chemicals properly. We haven't used them properly. And I've been talking about this for many, many years. I have a radio show that you can actually tune into Sundays Eastern Time. It is the longest running radio show on chemistry in the history of the world. Of course, it's the only chemistry show. So I can cherry pick data with the best of them. I've been at this since 1980, as is painfully obvious, of course, only because you see the dial telephone in the picture. And to tell you the truth, I don't remember the very first question I was asked when I was on the air, but I remember the second question that I was asked because it was a stunner. I was young and nervous at that time, and I thought I heard the caller ask this rather remarkable query. So I didn't know what to make of this. But all of a sudden, you start to have these strange anatomical juxtapositions go through your mind. But then it turned out that the caller was actually also quite nervous, and he had spoken very quickly, and he had forgotten a key word, which was golf. As I was to learn, golfers sometimes have the habit of picking up their golf ball and kissing it before putting it back down and whacking it. This is not for aerodynamic reasons, not a good idea to fill in the dimples with saliva. This is superstition. But the gentleman was worried because he had read about pesticides on golf courses, and he thought, gee, you know, maybe he was transferring some of these chemicals to his mouth, and it was a concern, not an illegitimate concern. So we talked about this for a while, and, you know, I explained to him that I don't think that there was a big risk here because the amount that could be transferred was not very significant. But that was the very first question that I was asked. And ever since that time, I've been asked thousands of questions, but interestingly enough, almost always based on perceived risk. For example, not long ago, I was asked this, is tripolyphosphate a chemical? You see, as soon as I hear that, I know what this caller is really asking. What they're really asking, is it dangerous? Because chemical is associated with toxin. Well, she had been looking at actually a pretty good cleaning agent and had come across this chemical, sodium tripolyphosphate, wanted to know what it was, and I explained. I said, look, you know, this is a chemical that is put in there in order to bind minerals in the water that would interfere with the detergent. And I think she was okay with that, because after all, if you expect to find chemicals somewhere, it's in cleaning agents. She calls me 2 weeks later, panic in her voice. I recognized her voice. She had once again crossed sodium tripolyphosphate, this time on a different label. It was a food. And it turned out that this was this marvel called Kraft Dinner. So she says to me, you know, I feed my son Kraft Dinner every day, which apparently was not a problem. Says, why am I giving him a cleaning agent? So I said, listen, this is actually a multi-talented chemical. You're not giving him a cleaning agent. Phosphates enhance water absorption by starch so that when your son clamors for his daily allotment of Kraft Dinner, you can deliver the goods more quickly. And I said, look, phosphates occur in nature. Anytime you eat meat, you're eating naturally occurring phosphate. It's not an issue. I don't think she bought it this time, because she didn't want chemicals in her food. It was okay in the cleaning agent. And she probably figured that the Kraft company, knowing that it was a messy business eating their product, had found a way to clean the kit from the inside out in order to boost sales. Where do they get such ideas? They get them from reading books like this by Ruth Winter, who has no business writing such a book. How do I make such a potentially libelous statement? Because I can back it up. If my phosphate-fearing friend looked up in this book, what would she find? Cuticle softener, bubble bath, etc. That makes sense for a cleaning agent. But also, incendiary bombs and tracer bullets. So now she would not only worry about her kid being cleaned from the inside out, she'd worry about him bursting into flame and disappearing, but not without a trace. So why does this author have no business writing such a book? Because she makes the most fundamental of all errors: confusing phosphorus with phosphate. Phosphorus is the element, and yes, it's dangerous. It is used in warfare, but you join it to oxygen to get phosphate, you have a completely different substance. This is like saying, well, you better be careful with water because it contains hydrogen, and hydrogen is what blew up the Challenger, right? But when you join hydrogen with oxygen, you get something that is totally different. I could even scare you about apples if I wanted to by misusing chemistry. If you bite into an apple, you know what you're tasting? This is what you're tasting. Over 300 different compounds. These are the natural components of the apple. These are the building blocks. These are not additives. And it includes things like acetone. The last time you encountered that was on the label of your nail polish remover where it says, do not drink. Also, among those chemicals is formaldehyde. That's embalming fluid. That's what morticians use. It's dangerous. Formaldehyde is a known carcinogen. It can kill you. So can acetone. So I could tell you, gee, you know, when you're eating an apple, you're eating a poison, acetone, that can kill you. But it's an economical way to go because you'll be pre-embalmed. Of course, it's total nonsense. Why? Because the amount that is in there is absolutely trivial. There are no safe substances. There are only safe ways to use substances. As Paracelsus, the great sage, told us over 500 years ago, only the dose makes the poison. Is aspirin poisonous? You get that question. Well, you know that aspirin is good for a headache. How much? If you take an aspirin tablet, you lick it, your headache will not go away. You take two tablets and swallow them, your headache will go away. You take the whole bottle of tablets and swallow them, and you will go away. So, is aspirin toxic? It all depends on the context. It all depends on numbers. In science, we worship numbers. We're always measuring things, we're weighing things, we're comparing in terms of numbers. So, for example, if a question comes up about bisphenol A, which is a chemical that is used to make polycarbonate plastics, it's a chemical that is used to make the epoxy liner inside of cans, there are concerns that come up. And I'm sure many of you have heard of the fact that this chemical shows up in our urine. And it has been labeled an endocrine disruptor, meaning that it interferes with hormonal activity. Now, that is potentially worrisome, of course. But in order to understand what the real risk is, we have to take a look at what experiments do, how much they use when they do the animal experiments, how much we're exposed to. We have to look at the numbers. And we can't always come to a conclusive answer because animals are not humans. The human is not a giant rat, with some exceptions. So you cannot always extrapolate. We basically make educated guesses based on the experiments that we carry out. But knowledge is elusive, and not everything can be known. So sometimes, you know, we just have to say, we don't know. But that is not a satisfactory answer to many people, and that's where the quacks jump into the picture, because they always have an answer. They know everything. For us, it's a question of evaluating risk against benefit. And no matter what you do in life, there's always some risk. You can be out for a casual walk, and it can be dangerous. Oh, don't go, oh, we're nice people, we faked it, they're fine. But you know what? They're not the innocent little creatures that you think that they are. There's risk with absolutely everything that we do. But if there's one point that I would like you to take away from here today, it's this one. That the presence of a chemical does not equal to the presence of risk. Today we have the ability of finding chemicals down to parts per trillion level because of our sophisticated mass spectrometers and gas chromatographs. A part per trillion is 1 second in 32,000 years. Think about that ratio. We can find that. This is not finding a needle in a haystack. This is finding a needle in a world full of haystacks. So tell me, if you were told that there's one needle in one haystack somewhere in the world, would you therefore forego a good old-fashioned roll in the hay? Probably not, because you would determine that the benefits outweigh the risks, right? Well, this is what we do in science all the time. We look at the risks, benefits. We also have to keep some important factors in mind. And these are, I know, confusing to a lot of people because they assume that if something is natural, it's good, and if it's synthetic, it's bad. I can tell you that in my many, many years of being in this business, this is the biggest myth I have to fight, that natural is good, synthetic is bad. Nature is not benign. Viruses, bacteria, poison ivy, snake venom, scorpions, these are all natural. We spend our life trying to overcome the ravages of nature by making use of synthetic substances. Now, of course, we do test those synthetic substances, and often, as I said, we test them on animals, but they are not perfect models. So we really cannot do much more than make educated guesses. And just to give you an example, dioxin, which is very often talked about as the most toxic substance that exists, it may well be if you're a guinea pig. However, if you're a hamster, you can practically frolic in the stuff. So it just goes to show you that even closely related animals will behave very differently upon exposure. It is very difficult to extrapolate to humans. It's even more difficult to extrapolate to the effect on children. The first thing that we teach our medical students when they do their pediatric rotation is that children are not small adults. They behave in a different way. You cannot just take body weight into account, because when the nervous system is developing, that's when you can easily throw a monkey wrench into the works. A substance that may be totally safe in an adult may be quite problematic in a child. No matter what we do, we can never prove that there's no risk associated with something, because in science you cannot prove a negative. You cannot prove that something can't happen. I'll give you an example. I don't think reindeer can fly, and you probably don't think they can fly. But I could not prove that. I could take a reindeer, take it up to the top of this building and nudge it off. And let's face it, if that animal ever in its life were motivated to fly, that's the moment. I think we'd have a mess at the bottom. I could repeat it again and again, I suspect with the same results. What could we conclude? That those animals today, for some reason, could not or chose not to fly. I can't tell you that there are not some reindeer, maybe 8 of them, given the right motivation, the right climactic conditions, the right date, maybe they can fly. So you can never prove a negative. And when we replace one chemical by another, you have to make sure that we know more about the one that we are replacing than the one that's being replaced. This takes me back to the bisphenol A story, because everyone is clamoring to get this out of our life. Well, the reason that epoxy resin is used in can liners is not because some manufacturer said, gee, you know, I don't think we've been spending enough money on our cans. Let's line them with some toxic material so we can sicken or maybe even kill off our customers. That's not how it happens, right? The reason it's there is to protect the food and to protect the can, because if you get pinholes in the can, you get bacteria entering and you have an unsafe food supply. But we have to make sure that the chemical that we're going to use to replace bisphenol A is safer And right now, we don't have an answer to that problem. In almost every area of science, there are opposing views. But just because they're opposing views doesn't mean that they have equal weight. Climate change is a great example. There are opposing views. However, one side has the vast majority of the scientific community on it. The other one has some minor outliers. I'll let you decide which is which. Almost any position in science can be supported by cherry-picking data, because there's so much being published. Every minute or every day, 365 days a year, there are 5 new scientific publications that come out. It's impossible to keep up to date even on a small sliver of the scientific world. And not all scientific publications are equally good. So you can always pick data to boost almost any view that you have. But in real science, what we do is we shake the tree. We don't pick individual cherries. We mash them together, and then we give it a taste. And then we come up with what amounts to an educated guess. That's really the way science works. But these days, we don't have enough scientific education, unfortunately. And that's why so many people worry about things that don't need to be worried about and don't worry about things that should be worried about. We need more education. If we can boost scientific education, we won't have people going into health food stores to buy aerobic oxygen thinking that this is going to make them live forever. This is the way that this is advertised. They tell you that we are robbed of oxygen. You put a few drops of this into a glass of water and you're going to be oxygenated. This is total nonsense. It contains a tiny bit of potassium chlorate because that really does release a trivial amount of oxygen. But in any case, we don't breathe through our gut. So putting oxygen into your stomach would be of no help whatsoever. This is total nonsense. Who buys this kind of stuff? I guess the same people who would buy dehydrated water, because you can convince people to buy almost anything these days if they don't have a scientific background. So we've got to improve upon that. We've got to start at the elementary school level. We have to push it right through high school, make sure that they are scientifically inclined. So this is not a question of saying, go, go chemistry, cheerleading for it. Not at all. That's not what I'm doing. It is a point that chemicals should not be locked away, neither should they be worshipped. They should be understood. And there's no question that we have gotten better at understanding them. Today, we deal with green chemistry. We know which are the processes that are less likely to do harm, which are the safest chemicals. And that's what we do. So I hope with what I've told you here today, I've changed your mind a little bit about what chemists can and cannot do, and that we're not a different species from others. It's just that we look at the molecules that surround us and come to some sort of conclusion. And we're filled with questions about what chemicals can and cannot do, and we don't always have the answers. Not everything in life has an answer. Sometimes we just have to be satisfied with that. We know what can be known, but we cannot know everything. And if you are further interested in the kind of things that we do, of course, have a website. You can catch me on Facebook. We also have an office Facebook page at McGill OSS. You can find that. But I put up here my personal Facebook page, because on a personal page, you can kind of be somewhat more straightforward. And I can criticize the food babe with the venom that is really deserved. Since this is a design presentation, I want to leave you with one idea. And it is really a design project. And it fits very nicely with what I said. Here's a little puzzle for you. I have this gizmo here with straight edges and hinges. And the question is, how many different shapes can we make with this? Well, obviously, we can make a square. We can make a parallelogram. We can make a pentagon. We can make a triangle. In fact, we can make 2 triangles. And the question is, can we make a circle? Well, you guys are great designers and logicians, and you look at that and say, of course you can't, right? Because you're dealing with hinges and straight edges. You can't make a circle. But the nice thing in science is that design can take on a different dimension, because you can look at something that everyone looks at and think something that no one else thinks by thinking outside the box. And you can actually take something that's a square and make it into a circle. And that's what we deal with in the world of science. We are trying to take those squares and making them into circles. And I'll leave you with one last idea, because I told you that I kind of got started with a rope trick. And I hope that I've been able to kind of unravel for you some of the mysteries of chemistry. Thank you.